Okay, folks, we're going to be going down an interesting rabbit hole today on this video. This is my certificate of live birth is what it is. It comes from the hospital. The doctor signs off on it. And the reason I got this is there's, this rumor, whatever, it's going around the internet that if you submit your certificate of live birth before you go to court and while you're entering court, this is proof that you are a living person or a sovereign, instead of the all uppercase legal fiction that the government, it's called a statutory entity, the government owns that. So I'll be doing this on the attack instead of on the defense. So usually the defendant is at a disadvantage. So there is no reason, maybe in the judge's eyes, for me to do this. Other, I'm trying to prove a point here. But this document, what I've is kind of messed up as far as I'm concerned. So just looking at the document, there is a few things that are in a box, and in the styles manual, things that are in a box are isolated from the contract or separate. They don't exist within the box. So we got a box there. And also, everything that is on my father's side is in a box, but on my mother's side, you can actually see that there is no box. Everything is on the open there. And same with the signature at the bottom. She signed at the lower right corner, which means that she's a creditor. Debitors sign on the left side, as well as the doctor signed at the bottom here at the lower right. Now, this has been pasted as a certified copy, so this signature down here in the middle, it's just certifying that it's a certified copy. It's on bond paper, government bond paper. So it's a real document here. Now let me just zoom in a bit and we'll break this down. So the top part is Province of British Columbia, Department of Health and Welfare, Division of Vital Statistics. So it's not part of the Treasury, which is what's on the back of my birth certificate. Receipt. Revenue receipt number, my account number, for treasury use only, which is kind of interesting. So it clearly states registration of live birth. So so I was born Vancouver, BC, at Vancouver General Hospital. Now this is the kicker, people. My name is all uppercase lettering. That's a person that is dead. Like it's on tombstones, the name's all uppercase because it means the person underneath this or representing that is dead. It's a statutory entity. It's a legal fiction. So I'm on a registration of live birth, but I'm down as a legal fiction. Now, a natural person can't, a legal fiction can't really give birth to a legal fiction. So you have to have, and here's my mother. See her name? It's lowercase lettering. She is a natural person. She's the one. So this is no mistake here. The way the father is boxed in, the mother isn't. Uppercase for me, lowercase for my mother. Even Canadian, the word Canadian. Even Irish and English. So just messed up. So anyways, we're going to keep going down here. Sex of child, male, single, twins, triplets, single. Okay, and our parents married? No. My birth date down there. My mother had two kids, including me, but actually there was more. I have seven half-brothers and sisters, and I don't know any of them. So what else is there? I was 7 pounds, 4 ounces, 44 weeks gestation. I guess that's normal. My father is unknown. So either she had lots of midichlorians in her, it was an immaculate conception, she didn't know my father's name, she did know, but for political, economic, or social reasons, she refused to have that on there. That's just kind of messed up. Irish. So she is Irish English. Now, Irish, whenever a culture is just squished and pounded, there's something to it. So basically, the Irish are directly linked genetically to the Anunnaki. They are directly linked to the gods. This is the most hidden culture in the world. It's probably next 20 years you're going to see a total retake on the whole Irish, from Atlantis to Lemuria to, you know, it's just fascinating what people are discovering and researching King Tut. They got a mummified dude in this pyramid, and what was it, 4 years ago, they take a DNA sample from him, and they analyzed it, and King Tut is Irish. Go figure, eh? So that's just the tip of the iceberg of what's happening with the Irish and English. So it seems like maybe that's why I always have internal conflicts, because the English are always fighting with the Irish and the Irish are always fighting with the English in me. But anyways, she was 27 when I was born. She was born in Edmonton, Alberta. She's a clerk typist. She was a clerk typist for the Canadian Armed Forces. And maybe that has something to do with me and my other brothers and sisters. Be interesting to see them. She lived on Davie Street in Vancouver. What's this? Mailing address as above. So this is pretty straightforward. And doctor signature. And there we have it. So, my mother gave birth to a legal fiction. Nice. I was given up right at birth, too. So, technically, this is a trust. The all uppercase version is a trust. So, she totally gave me over to the government. She was the grantor. The government, technically, in most situations, is the trustee. The legal fiction is the beneficiary, legally bound to the natural person, the living person, unless that's that relationship is severed legally. But in my case, the government actually kind of was the trustee and the administrator, or maybe it was my social worker, Dave Barrett. That could be, he was the administrator of the trust because he gave me access to it. I got $35 a month from my trust account, which he specifically said it was my trust account, from Victoria as kind of a monthly allowance. Very, very interesting. There's that. Now I'm going to start chipping away at some other stuff in case people are just stumbling across this and they haven't. Uppercase, lowercase, you're full of crap. It doesn't make any difference. Well, I wish it didn't, but it seems to have a huge difference. So I'm going to start chipping away at some other stuff to kind of substantiate what I'm saying on this one. Okay, so this is my famous You Don't Know What You Don't Know, and we're talking about the all uppercase statutory entity. This statutory entity, persona facta, is the all uppercase version of your name, Capitis Dementio. So let's just look up that, because on my living birth thing, it says that's what I am. So I will go and look this up for you. Okay. Capitis Dementio. Now, it's convenient that they say that it doesn't affect the name. But anyways, in terms used in Roman law referring to the extinguishing either in whole or part of a person's formal legal capacity. As the Romans only used I can't pronounce that, letters, capital letters, and had no minuscule letters. This does not refer to the capital letters in a name. Yeah, I don't believe that. But anyways, that's interesting how they put that in there. There were three changes to the state condition intended. Yeah, why would they? No, that someone just stuck that in. That doesn't make sense at all to have it not refer to the names. Because only a name, legal capacity. So is this a corporation? They didn't have corporations in Roman times. They had legal capacity. So no, this is the problem with Wikipedia, is they get people in slanting stuff. Anyways, there were three changes of a state condition intended with different consequences. Maxima, media, and minima. The greatest capitis dementio maxima involved the loss of liberty, citizenship, family, i.e. being made a slave, prisoner of war. Interesting, slave. So if your name's all uppercase lettering, you're either a prisoner of war, which looks like they are in the States, or a slave. The next change of state, capitis dementio media, consists of loss of citizenship and family without any forfeiture or personal liberty. The least of the state, capitis dementio minima, consisted of a person ceasing to belong to a particular family without loss of liberty or citizenship. Black's Law, meaning diminished status in Roman law, diminished or abridged from personality, from a person, everyone has a person, that's the uppercase, a loss of curtailment of a man's status or aggregate of legal attributes or qualifications. So you're going to court as a legal fiction with maximum diminished legal status. Man, that's messed up. And a lot of our laws are formed on Roman law, Latin, blah, blah, blah. So they still use it. So anyways, I'm a slave. Nice. So this lady here, I'm not even going to try to pronounce her name, but she's dealing with Moorish law. But she's got some good points on just law itself. So I'm going to just pick and choose some of the stuff here.
You understand the difference? Okay, jurisdiction. Then adjudication. Once you get to the part about adjudication, you have to ask the question, do you understand the law that applies to you, that applies to this matter? Because there's two types of jurisdiction, jurisdiction over the matter and jurisdiction over the person. All right? Does the court have both? They must have both in order to proceed. They don't tell you these things, but this is very important. So if the court has...
Now, if I come in as a sovereign, maybe that person, because a person is a legal person, that I own a person. The person is the uppercase version of me, which is illegally attached. Maybe I don't own it. The government owns it, but I can benefit from it or be harmed by it too. So that's interesting. Maybe that's the kicker why they don't really like people going in as a living sovereign.
It's as simple as that. And they understand the difference. This is why on their documents, they use words of art. They use the word label. They use the word person. They use the word address. All of these things that place you in their jurisdiction, and you unknowingly fill out forms every day. And every time you fill out a form, you enter into a contract. I don't care what kind of form it is. It's a contract. A driver's license application is a contract. A social security application is a contract. Don't ever think anything that you put your signature on becomes a contract. All right? The fact that you are not in your sovereign status means that you make a contract as a minor. They don't care. They know you are a minor. Because and to be other than a minor, you have to be in your proper person at law. And how we write that is this. When you are in your corporate ward status, you look like this to the court. Pro se. Pro se meaning they get you in the court and they bring someone in called a...
prosecutor.
Got that? Pro se cuter. a prosecutor because you're in a corporate board status. Now, if you're in propria persona, say in their criminal allegations, the prosecutor can't.
Okay, so let's look up in propria persona. Okay, so legal dictionary, in propria persona, acting on one's own behalf, generally used to identify a person who is acting as his or own attorney in a lawsuit. Popular abbreviation is in pro per. In the filed legal documents pleadings, the party's name, address, and telephone number are written where the name, address, and telephone number of the attorney would normally be stated. The words in propria persona or in pro per are typed where normally it would say attorney or plaintiff. Judges sometimes warn a party in propria persona of the old adage, anyone who represents himself in court has a fool for a client and an ass for an attorney. Yeah, okay, let's see. His own personal himself, defendant appeared in a propria persona. Okay, let's look up something else. Okay, here's another definition of in. This is from the Law Dictionary, and I'm not even going to try to say the Latin part here. In one's own proper person. In whatever thing one offends, in that he is rightfully to be punished. The punishment shall have relation to the nature of the offense. Okay, that's kind of weird.
And I come into the courtroom and say anything to you because you're not in pro se status. Makes sense, right? The issues of law are threefold. The issues of law are status, jurisdiction, and adjudication. The first thing that happens when you walk into a courtroom in your corporate ward status is that they already make the assumption that you are a ward of the state and that you don't know any better. So they immediately start adjudicating you. As the first thing that happens when we walk into a courtroom is that we place our status on the record, right? There is a language of silence. After you've said what you need to say, don't say any more. They will do the rest when you stand on your square. That's all you need to do. There's no need to stand there and argue with the judge, and trust me, I've done that. All right? And once you say what you need to say, they know everything else to do. But understand, they do not want you exposing the truth to their corporate wards, because every slave that you take out of their corporation, they lose money. This is making business. So don't go into the courtroom trying to expose the fraud. That's not your job. That's not why you're there. There's another venue for that. In that courtroom, because understand, it's not court, because it's not law. And I'm going to get into that in a few minutes. So don't try to challenge them on the law. They already know that. They already know they don't have the proper status. They already know they're operating in your land fraudulently. All right? Just say what you have to say and back off. They will give you the window. And it's up to you. If you are educated enough about the law, you'll see the window, you'll recognize it, and then you'll be able to walk through it and walk out the door. But if you're not conscious, when they open the window for you, I'll give you an example. As I gave in class just a few nights ago, went into the courtroom and the judge has papers there in front of me and he's just arguing with me, young lady, you'd better come back here. I'm gonna send all these officers I have at my disposal with guns to hunt you down and bring you. And he's just running his mouth. And the prosecutor slides me the paper to sign and it was blank. Do you understand? Do you understand? So I signed the paper because I know how to sign contracts and not be obligated to them.
And I think how you sign a contract and not be obligated is you sign it at the top on the right-hand side, because it covers everything above. And there has to be three lines. If your signature is at the top portion of a page, there has to be three lines of the contract minimum on that page to make that signature actually valid. So I think that's what she's talking about there.
All right, so I did that, signed the blank piece of paper. They took a copy, I took a copy, and I left. And I never heard from them again. But if I had stood there, as I shared with class, and I have done this, this paper is blank, and I'm not signing it, and, right? So, all I had to do was come into the courtroom and say what I had to say. Now, I know how to present myself in the courtroom, Islam, right? And see the window and walk out.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying.
Now, the next issue at law is jurisdiction. We already know they don't have the status. Now, do they have the jurisdiction? The answer is no. Because in order to have jurisdiction, you must first prove status. Everybody in the courtroom must have status on the record. Why is that so important? Because unless their status is on the record, what country do you represent? Says what law you're here to get justice on, right? Now, if you have not clarified the status for the record, you can't bring your law into the court. So there can be no court. So status is very important. And I guarantee you, because status has not been established for the record, they're not using any law that applies to you. And they're not using any law that applies to them. They're simply using corporate policy, which is discretionary. If they like you today, they'll let you off. If they don't like you tomorrow, they'll give you some time or a fine. Okay? So status and then jurisdiction. Jurisdiction is going to determine what area, what geographical area encompasses the authority that that judge or that court has. All right? So if you're in a municipal court or a court of common pleas, don't go in there talking about the Constitution because they don't have jurisdiction to discuss the Constitution with you. Do not go into a...
Actually, in Canada, any court, small claims all the way up to Supreme Court, any court of competent jurisdiction can hear any matter dealing with the Canadian Constitution, and I'll dig that up in a video and post it. And that in the actually I'll post it in the transcripts because I brought up the Constitution. He says the judge said the Constitution doesn't apply here. So, anyways.
State court discussing the Constitution, unless it's the state's Constitution, because the United States' Constitution they have no jurisdiction over, but they won't tell you that. They'll dismiss the case. Different jurisdictions. And don't go into federal court talking about city ordinances. You understand the difference? Okay. Jurisdiction. Then adjudication. Once you get to the part about adjudication, you have to ask the question, do you understand the law that applies to you, that applies to this matter? Because there's two types of jurisdiction. Jurisdiction over the matter and jurisdiction over the person. All right? Does the court have both? They must have both in order to proceed. They don't tell you these things, but this is very important. So if the court has gotten to the point of adjudication, all right, which for me, I don't have that problem. But once the court gets to the point of adjudication, then they're ready to start prosecuting. They're ready to find you guilty of something, some kind of way. And the reason for that is because it's a business. And once you enter there and they seize jurisdiction over you, they adjudicate for the sole purpose of getting some money. That's that. Okay. Color of law. Colorable, color, means something that pretends to be something that it's not. Colorable court, colorable money, colorable law, colorable people. Any people who call themselves colored, Negro, African American, Indian, Puerto Rican, Chinese, Australian, all of these are colorable labels, but these people for the most part around the world don't even know this. But because they call themselves Chinese, as I was getting ready to say to you, they are part of a corporate nation state as well, because the country of China is Manchuria, the nation state. The corporate ward nation state is China. That is not the country or the sovereignty of the people. The people are Manchurian, all right? You understand? Say anybody who wants to call themselves Puerto Rican. Puerto Rico is a corporate nation state. It is a private, nonprofit corporation that has a charter issued by the Moors where they have the authority to conduct commerce and trade on the island of Borincano. Borinqua, right? Borinqua. That's the name of the people. Borincano is the name of the island. Puerto Rico is the private nonprofit corporation that has the charter to operate within the geographical boundaries of Borincano. Most Puerto Ricans don't even know that. I go around telling people all the time, you're not this, you're not that. This is who you really are, because people have grown up into slavery for generation after generation in all these corporate nation states who belong to the United Nations, which is a private nonprofit corporation, trade association for nation state corporations. Got it? In order to belong to the United Nations, you have to be a corporate ward state, nation state. Otherwise, they don't want you. And they will go to war against a country and take the people out of their sovereign capacity and say they're setting up democracy all around the world so that they can take people out of their sovereign capacity and take them away from the law and impose corporate statute on them. And that's exactly what they do. All right? Now, color of law is in full swing all around the world. All around the world. And they have a clique where they're all intermingled and they all agree to participate together in this game. Right? Now, it doesn't matter where you go. Just like most people think you need a passport to travel from company to company to company that are called nation states. So you do need a passport if you call yourself black or African American or a U.S. citizen or any of those things. Yes, you need a passport to travel from one corporate nation state to another. But when you're traveling from one country to another, you do not need a passport. And those countries will tell you you don't. Depends on what you call yourself. You understand? All law. Do we praise all law? Absolutely. Do we praise Christ? Absolutely. Because what, not who, what is Christ? Christ is the great I am. And if you know what Islam means, let me tell you this. I, self, law, am master. I am the master of my own fate. I am all law. All right?
So this is Paul Halliard. He's retired defense minister for Canada, acting prime minister at times for Canada. And there's a little quote I just want you to hear from him.
Perhaps the United Nations might be invited by the Muslims to convene a meeting of both temporal and religious leaders in search of a better way of settling grievances and differences. Meanwhile, it's time that all the Abrahamic religions, Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, kissed and made up. I was in my 80s before I knew that Allah was my God. My guess is that the majority of Christians are equally ill-informed. And the Israelites should start treating Palestinians as the blood brothers that they really are.
Yep. So Allah is his God. Apparently Allah is the Christians' gods. And what that other lady was talking about, Allah, Allah, Allah. So I guess Allah is what everyone should adhere to and praise. So anyways, there's that.
When you walk into the courtroom and you know these things, trust me, you get a different result. A court is also a corporation. They don't hide that from you. They put it right on the seal right behind the judge. And they tell you that this court was incorporated in 1878, whatever it is. This court was incorporated, and what words do they use? Founded. So when you see the word founded and you see the word established in, it already tells you that they're a corporation. Understand? And anybody who owns a corporation does what? Own a slave. Because a corporation is a slave holder. Understand?